It's kind of an odd thing to have to introduce a short story. You hope it's a self-contained entity. And so I prepared a brief statement that is hopefully of some interest. Flannery O'Connor said that everyone knows what a story is until they sit down to write one. If I required more proof of this than my own attempts have provided, I'd need to look no further than the writer's workshop, where peers weigh in on your work with helpful comments. This is as interesting as watching paint dry, said one student, himself the author of a story about a unicorn that lamented its bachelordom with the pun, "I'm horny." Said another, directed at me, "Writing about your own life is so self-masturbatory," which left me wondering, perhaps naively, what other sort of masturbatory there is. It wasn't just classmates, either. Once, after a lengthy discussion, one professor had placed his face in his hands and said wearily, "I think we're arranging deck chairs on the Titanic." The surprise that accompanies comments like this is, I think, in realizing that what we set out to write isn't necessarily what we do write. In some cases, it's because what we imagined seemed, at the time, worthwhile, and in others, it's because the idea changes somewhere along the way and surprises us. I wrote Patterson over a year ago, and it began as a non-fiction testimonial for a local coffee shop. My task was to write 300 or so laudatory words that would be included in a sort of anthologized guide to the city. As I started, it became clear that while a compliment here or there has its merits, complaining, to me, is much more pleasurable. Who cared that there were always napkins and clean tables when this cafe segregated, by force, the people on laptops from the people without them? If there was free Wi-Fi, why in 2016 was there a fee for paying with a credit card, and did anyone actually believe the sign claiming this was a cash discount? Gone was the glowing testimonial, and here in its place was something that shaped itself as it came, a story that was as much a found thing as a written one. In fact, the less I tried to make it any particular thing, the more particular of a thing it became. Madeline Lengel said, "Don't think, write. We think before we write a story and afterward, but during the writing we listen." It is, I suppose, small surprise that the manner in which a story is created is so closely tied to the way in which it is consumed, by listening. And this seems especially relevant tonight. Thank you all for being here and for listening.
All this started in a coffee shop. You might know the one. It's on the corner. I walked in and saw the female barista had a pale mustache. Good for you, I thought. The ways of the superficial world have not availed themselves of you. Then she said her register, a computer, did not accept credit cards. So I asked if she shaves or waxes. Then before she could answer, I whispered, "Silly me," so only she could hear it. "Of course it's neither." She looked upset. I'm upset. I'll tell you why. Because I feel like all of the other people here know one another and all of them would like me to leave. That's because this coffee shop is like a closed club, and when I show up, they're all like, "Can he not see that this is a closed club to which he was clearly not invited? Did he not get the memo?" It's like that. This is why I sat outside on a day that is so hot my stone table is like a griddle. So what if the cookie I got bakes a second time, I think. But I don't let it bother me. Especially when the alternative is to sit inside and suffer the oppressive aura of hipsterdom. "You're not cool enough," it says. And it's 109 Fahrenheit right now, and so you think, "Ha! That's ironic." And it says, "You can only be ironic if you are cool." And you think, it's ironic because to be cool I'd have to be inside. And then you realize that actually you have been saying all of this out loud and that people, just a few, not very many, only one infant, have been watching you. And they have been wondering why you are pounding on the table, and why between poundings you are dipping your fist in your iced tea. And you explain that you are doing this to cool it off, but by this point the tea is splashed everywhere and your cookie is basically mush, and the people are looking more concerned and the infant is sort of squirming like, "Hey, I'm an infant, can someone get me out of this heat?" And then you hear, "See, now this is ironic." And you think, "No, this is not ironic. This is just a little odd." And then Miss Mustache Barista says something about calling the authorities. And then you are being told that whether this is ironic or just odd, it's not okay to remove your pants in public. And you think, "When did I remove my pants?" And it says in the voice of the fireman with the megaphone, "It really doesn't matter where your pants are, sir. Just come down off that ledge." And this is a little bit why I'm not happy right now. I'm not blaming anyone, not really. The thing about always going to the same coffee shop is that you start to recognize people. Maybe you even a little bit think of them as friends. Obviously, you don't tell them this. You don't say hello. These are friends whose existence you notice only. One of these people, a student, I think, a graduate in mathematics. Well, this guy always wore such nice shirts. They were usually button-downs in interesting colors, especially for a math person. Like yellow and blue checkers, or this sort of medley of fall colors that was not quite plaid. It made you think he was edgy without being ridiculous, and organized without being dull. So today I decided, fuck it! I've seen him enough, whatever. So I go sit by him, but I don't know what to say. That's always my problem. What do I say? Then it said, "Why don't you say something ironic? Leave me alone!" But see, I guess I said that last part out loud, so this guy turns and says, "Sorry?" And he was so handsome. I didn't know what to do. So I pulled out my book and opened it. I didn't mean to pack a science textbook. I forgot I even had it. I mean, I wondered why my bag was so heavy, but I didn't realize it was that book. So you can see that I certainly didn't mean to open it to that page. And when I did, and you have to understand that I was sitting right beside him, I froze. He froze. We both froze. Then he was sort of looking at me with this really weird kind of, "Well, this can't be good," expression on his face. So I thought I had to do something fast, and so I said, "I'm studying to be a... And I had to remember the word, urologist! And I sort of hoped that would explain away the awkwardness of there being a photo of a penis open on the table right in front of us. But he sort of choked. And so, because I couldn't think of anything else to say, I said, "Kiss me." Then he got up quickly and grabbed his bag and knocked the chair over on his way to the door. "I love your shirt!" I called out. But by then he was gone. So I took my tea and the cookie and I went outside to get some air. But my table was hot, and then I was putting my hand in the tea and people gathered, and now here I am on a ledge and I don't exactly remember how I got here and I still have not relocated my pants. I should back up. All this is because of Kelly. She used to come with me to this coffee shop. We would sit outside and watch people. Like this old woman who wore her hair in cornrows and one time said to someone sitting with her, "I have a fabulous time in my bereavement group." If the woman heard us laugh, she pretended not to. That was the day I told Kelly. She was the first person I told, actually, right here in this coffee shop. We each had a glass of iced tea, and when we stopped laughing, there was a long quiet. And then she said gently, "You said you had something to tell me?" I'd gotten to the point where I had to tell someone. I was done being someone else, someone false, someone who was always afraid. I watched our glasses perspire. My mouth was totally dry. "I sort of knew already," she told me when I finally said it, which is what people always say. It's your voice, or your mannerisms, or that time you turned your head when the shirtless jogger ran by. Kelly and I met in a drama class, so maybe she just assumed I was gay. We did a scene together. She played the mom, and I played the son. "No, Mom," I said, "you can't change the channel with this." "Why not?" she said. "Because, Mom, this is the house phone." Pause for laughter. We were actually not bad together. Especially since I hardly knew her then. She wore thick boots like she walked home through a rainforest. I hadn't been at school for a while because my mom doesn't handle things well. She found a box in my room with stuff in it that she especially did not take well. I was not the son she wanted, she said. She'd threatened therapy, talked about a cure, so I escaped. And then they found me and brought me to the hospital. When they let me out, Mom told me I couldn't live at home anymore. Parasite, she said. So I found a small apartment and a job and worked nights, like Kelly. Kelly, she started encouraging me to go talk to guys, like the nice shirt guy. Just try it, she said. It's only scary before you do it. But I never could. I never did. It meant a lot to me, what Kelly said. She was religious, or her dad was religious. Crazy religious. But she hadn't seen him in a long time. He'd been in prison. She never said why. I suspected it had something to do with why her mom wasn't around. Still, talking with her was like being able to say, okay, we don't believe the same thing, maybe, but we can still come together. One night when we left the coffee shop, I asked if I could drive her home. That's how I first went to Patterson, which was a farm town, but is now mostly an empty town. It just seemed to stretch on forever, this unending flatland under a carpet of brown, short grass. Here and there was a gas station or a quickie mart, maybe a sandwich joint, but nothing else really. And it was way out in the middle of nowhere. Like when people say something is an East Jesus nowhere, they mean somewhere that's actually closer than Patterson, which is about 30 miles past East Jesus nowhere. I drove her so we could have more time to talk. Kelly was the first person who knew me as me and didn't hate me for it. Like things had finally started over. Then her dad got out. You'd better be home before dark, he told her. Why does he care? I asked. And she said, because nothing of the Lord happens outside the home after dark. Like he was afraid of witchcraft or something. One evening, we got to Patterson while the sun was still up. I used this to convince Kelly to see a movie with me. We went to one of the gas stations and got sodas and snuck them into the theater. When Kelly opened the first bottle, this geyser of foam shot out of her purse. It was the funniest thing I'd seen in a long time. People kept shushing us, but we didn't care. Laughing again was like rediscovering something I'd forgotten I knew how to do. By the time I dropped her off, it was almost midnight. I didn't see her for 3 days after that. You didn't just want to wear a welding visor? I said when she got in my car again. That's how big the sunglasses were, like satellite dishes. They covered her whole face almost. And then she took them off. She'd hidden as much of it as she could with makeup, but you could still see the bruises. I knew that sort of thing happens to people, but it's different when it happens to someone near you. Someone you know. You almost think that if you ignore it, maybe it will go away. Maybe it will be like it never happened. Kelly didn't usually have money, but she paid for dinner that time. Wouldn't hear a word otherwise. Wouldn't even let me reach for my wallet. We didn't talk about her face or what it meant. We talked about other things. Things I don't even remember. Things that didn't matter. I was too afraid of saying the wrong thing. And I guess she thought there wasn't anything for her to say. I didn't want to take her home. I wanted her to stay with me or someone, anyone else. But she said that'd make it worse, and anyway she'd be fine, she was tough. And she was working late, and he was working late. He'd gotten a job in construction on a highway somewhere. So we went back to Patterson. Almost 2 weeks before I saw her again. When I finally saw her again, she was wearing a cast. It seemed unreal. It was unreal. This didn't happen, but it did happen. It had happened. She didn't want another ride. She didn't want me there. She wanted to be left alone. "You don't have to live like this," I told her. "No one has to live like this." I felt like I knew. I felt like she might listen because she knew what I'd gone through and that I'd gotten out. But she wouldn't hear it. "Family. Another chance." That's what she said. "This isn't family," I said. "You're not family," she said. I was quiet for a moment. Then I said, "At least let me give you a ride." I hoped that I might change her mind if I had more time. On the way home, she told me her dad had realized the money was missing from under his mattress. Kelly was tough, like she said. He'd come after her, didn't even wait for a confession or a lie. Said she'd done the devil's work and he was going to have to make it right. She'd stolen money, and for a boyfriend, no less. He'd been taking off his belt when she said that I wasn't her boyfriend. "More lies," he'd said. "No lies," she'd said. "You disappoint me," he'd said. "Liar. Whore." And she told him, of course, I wasn't her boyfriend because it wasn't that way. I wasn't that way. And I guess that's when it went bad. Worse, even. Awful. "You have to understand what happened to him," she said. "What he's gone through." "What about what's happened to you?" I said. She was fiddling with the window control and not looking at me. And then she told me she thought it was a choice. She said her dad had explained it to her, had made it clear. "Demons," she said, "were in all of us and made everyone do terrible things." I didn't say anything to that. I just took the exit for Patterson. They've brought a ladder, or one of those ladders that's part of a fire truck. I'm not sure that's actually called a ladder. The guy with the megaphone is talking again. "Come down," he says. And I yell back that I'm waiting for them to use the ladder. And actually, since it came up, what is the ladder on the fire truck actually called? "A hydraulic arm." "Not like it's going to help," it said. I look down. The old woman with the cornrows is below now, too, in the crowd, looking up, concerned. I wonder if she'll mention all this to her bereavement group. I almost wish I could tell her that I wrote it down, what she said. "Fun bereavement group," I'd written. Sometimes in the middle of the day, I open my notebook and just look at that sentence. It gives me hope. If mourners can come together and laugh, maybe it means that happiness is never gone forever. Or at least, that it can coincide with grief. I mention this because I never saw Kelly again, which came with its own kind of grief. I'd lost something I didn't even know I had. Her, I guess. Us. Now the guy with the megaphone is saying that they can't use the hydraulic arm because I am only a single story up and the arm is too long. Ironic. It doesn't seem like the fall will kill me. It might even leave my arms and legs functional. Maybe I will only break one of each. Or maybe you'll paralyze yourself and spend the rest of your life dripping urine into a catheter, it says. No one likes you, I think.
Sir, please, says the man with the megaphone. Someone somewhere likes you.
I wouldn't bet on it, it says.
Sir,
says the man.
Sir, no!
By now, the infant has started to cry. Kelly asked me once where I thought we went when we died. Where do you think we go when, well, you know, she'd said. She couldn't even say the word. I think it was because she thought she was religious but really wasn't. I knew what that was like. Thinking of yourself as one thing when you are actually another. For her asking the question and saying the word meant she'd be admitting doubt. And I don't think she had room in her heart for that. When you grow accustomed to horror and then it stops, you have to relearn again how to do more than just survive. You can remember things that hadn't seemed to matter. Long drives, movies, watching a glass of iced tea perspire while you sit outside with a friend. These things are nothing. And they are everything. Where do I think we go when we die? For a long time, I thought it would be a place I'd recognize when I got there, somewhere empty and barren. Such a place would be fitting for the dead, for the souls of the lost to wander aimlessly. But now I think of it as somewhere else entirely, a place with soft soil and trees that don't ever wither, a place you might not expect to hear laughter. But you do. You do. Thank you very much.